Mr. President, it's now been 3 weeks, more than 3 weeks, since the House passed two articles of impeachment against the President of the United States. It was a big day for them at the time, and one they've been dreaming of and speaking of since the President was inaugurated nearly 3 years ago. For as long as House Democrats have been wanting to impeach the President, they only spent a fraction of that time on the impeachment inquiry itself. Matter of fact, they rushed headlong into a partisan impeachment process, and now they're trying to make up for the mistakes that Chairman Schiff and Speaker Pelosi made in proceeding in the House in the first place. For example, they're now want to relitigate things like executive privilege and whether testimony of other witnesses should be included in the Senate impeachment trial. In other words, the House wants to tell the Senate how to conduct the trial. Well, the House had its job to do, and frankly, I think mishandled it, but now they have no say in the way the Senate conducts the impeachment trial, when and if Speaker Pelosi decides to send them over here. 12 weeks was all it took for House Democrats to come up with what they believed was enough evidence to warrant a vote on articles of impeachment. I think they are experiencing some buyer's remorse. During that 12 weeks, we repeatedly heard House Democrats say how urgent the matter was, seemingly using urgency as an excuse for a slapdash investigation that they did, that they now regret. So when the House concluded that their rushed investigation and passed two articles of impeachment, we all expected those articles to be sent to the Senate promptly. Now, this is only will be the third time in American history where the Senate has actually convened a trial on articles of impeachment. So this is kind of a new, novel process for most of us here in the Senate. I think there were only 15 senators who were here during the last impeachment trial of President Bill Clinton. So most of us are trying to get up to speed and figure out how do we discharge our duty under the Constitution as a jury that will decide whether to convict or acquit, and if convict, whether the President should be removed. This is serious stuff. And here we are about 11 months before the next general election. You know, it strikes me as a serious matter to ask 535 members of the United States Congress to remove a President that was voted into office with about 63 million votes. This is very serious. Well, despite House leadership and members stating time and time again before the Christmas holidays how pressing the matter of impeachment was, there hasn't been an inch of movement in the House since those articles of impeachment were voted on. So here we are more than 3 weeks later, and Speaker Pelosi still is playing her cat and mouse game with these articles of impeachment. Last night, the Speaker appears to have dug in her heels even deeper when she sent a letter to our Democratic colleagues about the delay. Following the Majority Leader's announcement that every Republican senator supports using exactly the same framework that was used during the Clinton impeachment trial, the Speaker, as you might imagine, wasn't particularly happy, because her gambit obviously didn't work. She has zero leverage and zero right to try to dictate to the Senate how we conduct the Senate trial, just like we have zero leverage and zero input into how the House conducted its responsibilities. Speaker Pelosi told her caucus that the process was both unfair and, quote, designed to deprive senators and the American people of crucial documents and testimony. Clearly, she doesn't think those documents and testimony were crucial enough to be included in the House investigation in the first place, but I digress. The Speaker is trying to make the most out of a very bad situation of her own creation, and intentionally trying to mislead the American people into thinking this framework prevents any witnesses from testifying, which is a false impression. It's demonstrably false. These are the same parameters that guided the Clinton impeachment process, during which witnesses were presented by deposition, by sworn out of the Senate testimony that was then presented by the parties. So in 1999, 100 senators agreed to this model. You would think that if this was fair enough for President Clinton, it would be fair enough for President Trump. But to apply a different standard would be just that, a double standard. Well, all 100 senators agreed during the Clinton impeachment trial to allow the impeachment managers to present their case, to allow the president's lawyers to present their case, and then to permit the senators to ask questions through the Chief Justice and to get additional information, and then and only then decide whether additional witnesses would be required. Under the Clinton model, and now under the model that will be used, the Clinton model we'll be using in the Trump impeachment trial, if members felt like they needed more information, they could vote to hear from additional witnesses. That opportunity is still available to them under the Clinton precedent that will be applied in the Trump impeachment trial. And that's exactly what happened in the Clinton impeachment trial. After the arguments and evidence was presented, senators voted to hear from three additional witnesses who were then deposed and whose sworn testimony was then offered. You know, it makes me a little crazy when people say this is a question of witnesses or no witnesses. There were about 17 witnesses, as I count them, that testified in the House impeachment inquiry. All of that evidence, such as it is available to the impeachment managers to offer here in the Senate. And if, in fact, the Senate decides to do as the Senate did in the Clinton impeachment, authorize subpoenas for three additional witnesses or more, that still is the Senate's prerogative, which is not foreclosed in the least by this resolution. Well, the Intelligence Committee alone held 7 public hearings with 12 witnesses that totaled more than 30 hours. Presumably, they're proud of the product, the evidence that was produced during the course of those hearings, or else they wouldn't have conducted them in the first place. So this isn't a matter of witnesses or no witnesses, as some of our Democratic colleagues and the media attempts to characterize it. This is a matter of letting the parties to the impeachment decide how to try their case. I've had the great honor over a period of 13 years of serving as a state court judge. I've presided over hundreds of jury trials during the course of my experience as a district judge. Never have I seen a model where the jury decides how to try the case. The jury sits there and listens to the evidence presented by the parties, and that's exactly what we are proposing here. So this idea of letting senators decide how to try the impeachment manager's case or the president's case is something totally novel and unheard of. Well, setting the rules on who we hear from, when and how, as the speaker wants to do, on the front end makes no sense. This is, let me try an analogy, Mr. President. It'd be like asking an NFL coach to outline every play in the Super Bowl in order before the game actually starts. Well, that's not possible. Having this discussion over Speaker Pelosi's demands on witnesses completely ignores the fact that this is simply not her prerogative. Now, I know the Speaker is a powerful political figure. She rules the House with an iron fist, but her views simply have no weight whatsoever in terms of how the Senate conducts its business, including an impeachment trial under the Constitution. So this has all been diversion and, frankly, a lot of dissembling and misleading arguments about things that just simply aren't true. The Constitution outlines a bicameral impeachment process with each chamber having its separate and independent responsibilities. As I said, just as the Constitution gives the House the sole power of impeachment, that's a quote from the Constitution, it also gives the Senate, quote, the sole power to try all impeachments, close quote. Nowhere is found a clause granting the Speaker of the House of Representatives supreme authority to decide this process. Yes, she's been very influential leading up to the vote on the Articles of Impeachment, over which the Senate had no voice and no vote. But now her job, such as it is done, but to send the Articles of Impeachment to the Senate. Speaker Pelosi's refusal to transmit the articles unless her demands are met is a violation of the separation of powers. And it's an unprecedented power grab. I must say, I have some sympathy with the Speaker's position. Last March, she said impeachment was a bad idea because it was so divisive, and unless the evidence was compelling and the support for the articles of impeachment was bipartisan, it wasn't worth it. Well, that was in March of 2019. Obviously, things changed, and the best I can tell is she was essentially forced by the radical members of the House Democratic Caucus to change her position, and now she finds herself in an embarrassingly untenable and unsustainable position. So this isn't entirely her fault. While she's been playing games, though, with the articles of impeachment, she's been infringing, I believe, on the president's constitutional right to due process of law. Due process is based on the fundamental notions of fairness. That's what we accord everybody in a civil or a criminal proceeding, due process of law. The Sixth Amendment, for example, guarantees the right to a speedy trial for every American, and it doesn't exempt certain cases, no matter how high or low profile they may be. Now, while the Sixth Amendment right to speedy trial may not, strictly speaking, apply to an impeachment trial, because this isn't a civil or criminal case, the whole fundamental notion of fairness does apply, a right to a speedy trial. And it's clear that while Speaker Pelosi dangles these articles of impeachment over the president like a sword of Damocles, this is not fair to the president. It's not fair to the Senate. It's not fair, most importantly, to the American people. This distraction, this impeachment mania, has consumed so much oxygen and attention here in Washington, D.C., that it's prevented us from doing other things we know we can and should be doing that would benefit the American people. I've come here on two occasions to offer a piece of bipartisan legislation that would lower out-of-pocket costs for prescription drugs by eliminating some of the gamesmanship in the patent system, only to find, even though it's a bipartisan bill voted unanimously out of the Judiciary Committee, the only person that objected to us taking it up and passing it was the Democratic minority leader. So those are the sort of games that, unfortunately, give Washington and Congress a bad name and a bad reputation. And I must say, Mr. President, this is not just this side of the aisle that thinks the time is up for Speaker Pelosi to send the articles of impeachment over here. There is bipartisan agreement here in the Senate that it's time to fish or cut bait. Speaker Pelosi's California colleague, our friend Senator Feinstein from California, said, if we're going to do it, she should send them over. I don't see what good delay does. Well, good for Senator Feinstein. Our friend and colleague from Connecticut, Senator Blumenthal, said, we are reaching a point where the articles of impeachment should be sent. Senator Murphy, his colleague from Connecticut, said, I think the time has passed. She should send the articles over. And I think we all share the sentiment expressed by Senator Angus King from Maine, He said, I do think we need to get this thing going. He has a gift for understatement. Mr. President, it's high time for the Speaker to quit using these articles of impeachment as a way to pander to the most radical fringes of her party. The members of the House have completed their constitutional role. They launched their inquiry. They did their investigation, such as it was, and they held a partisan vote. That's their prerogative. I don't agree with it, but that's their prerogative, and they've done it. So, Mr. President, the Speaker should send the articles of impeachment to the Senate without further delay so we can perform our responsibilities under the Constitution in a trial. Mr. President, I yield the floor.